Well, good morning. That's it? That's all you got? Good morning. Say it like you mean it. It's good to see you here today. Thank y'all for being here. It's good to see some smiles on your faces. I told a congregation one morning, and I said, smile if you got your teeth. There was a lady right back here, didn't have her teeth. And you know how good Baptists are. They let you know about it. And so I don't say that anymore. But anyway, it's so good to see you. We serve an awesome God, don't we? He's on his throne, and you know, if he doesn't show up the Holy Spirit, everything we do is in vain. And so as we worship, your worship invites the presence of the Holy Spirit. That's what we want to do today, and we're so glad that you're here. And so stand up. If you see somebody beside you that quit smiling, pump them in the ribs right there. Tell them that was the Holy Spirit nudge. Okay? Here we go. Watching by way of live stream, you're welcome here, and we're so grateful that with all the places you could be today that you'd be here, and we're excited. We anticipate a great move of the Holy Spirit today. Amen? Five of you think so, huh? You know that our attitude and how we arrive in this place really dictates whether the Holy Spirit is allowed here or not, and I want so bad for him to show up and show out today. There's so many people that are in need. There are many of you in here that are in need, including myself, have unspoken prayer requests. God is a good God. He loves you so much. He loves you so much that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him will never perish but have everlasting life. Isn't that a great message? A great, great scripture. We are glad if you're visiting with us today, or if you're visiting with us today online, you can put your information there. But in front of you guys here, there's a white card. If you'll fill out as much information as you're comfortable with us having, social security number, bank account, those kind of things. No, I'm kidding. As much as you're comfortable with, and then place that in the basket as you're leaving today. And also for our members and our guests, if you have a prayer request, we would consider it an honor as staff to be able to partner with you in prayer for that. And so we're so glad today to have Dr. Ken Alford and his bride. They've been here before. They're such a blessing. We've known Brother Ken for many, many years. He still looks the same. I don't. But we are so blessed that they're here. Pray for him as he gives the message today. Pray that we would have spirit ears and spirit eyes to see and hear what God has for us. All right? Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we're going to continue to worship. Father, we love you. You are an awesome God. Lord, we bless your holy name today, not only with the words and the songs that come from our mouth, but Lord, we bless you today, Lord, by the way we live our lives. Our lives are a worship service, and we have influence, either good or bad, on everybody that we're around, our family. So, Lord, I pray that you would help us today to realize that the church that lives is us. Each one of us are the church. Lord, help us to have influence in our world. Lord, I pray that you'd help us. A lot of times we get down and negative, and the enemy wants to remind us of our past. Lord, we know that as we ask forgiveness for that, Lord, that your word says you throw it to the sea of forgiveness, as far as the east is from the west. Lord, help us to walk in victory. Help us to walk in confidence. Not perfect, Lord, but the same Spirit that rose Jesus from the dead is the same Spirit that lives inside of us, that guides us and directs us. Lord, I pray we'd be bold in our witness. I pray that we would take a stand, Lord. And I pray, Father, that this nation would turn back to you. Lord, I pray for those that are sick, Lord, with the COVID and the flu and the cold. Lord, you tell us by your stripes we are healed. Father, we claim your promises. We claim your word. Lord, you tell us that when we seek you, when we seek you with all of our heart, that we will find you. Father, may we be seekers. Lord, may we run after you and press into you every day. May we read your word, Lord, and hide it deep in our heart and meditate on it. Lord, help it become natural when somebody says something or we're in a situation, Lord, instead of us having our will and saying what we want. Lord, would you speak through us to make a difference? Lord, we come today and we love you. We thank you, Lord, for this great opportunity and the privilege that we have. May you receive all glory and honor today. Lord, we ask it, we believe it, Lord, we receive it in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. If you're able this morning to stand, please stand. If you're not, it's fine if you sit. Let's worship. And I've done it for about 15 years, but it's new to us. I love songs that come from Scripture. In Zephaniah, it says, "The Lord your God is in your midst. A mighty one will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love." Listen to this. "He will exult over you with loud singing." Our God not only gave his perfect son for us, but he sings over us. To me, that blows my mind, that while we walk during the day, while we worship, our God, the God that created everything, sings over somebody so insignificant like me. Isn't that great? Two of you, that's great. Come on, we're going to have church today, amen? Let's don't go through the motions today. Let's ask the Spirit of God to move in this place and change lives, amen? Sing this with us if you know it. If you don't, you'll learn it. It's real easy. Sing over me. Here it is. Songs of deliverance, Lord.
Sing over me, one. Thank you.
shouted. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Look toward the screen, please.
Hey, church family. I want to take a minute again and thank you for praying for Paige and me while we're on our trip. We look forward to seeing you all and being back in fellowship with you all and worship very, very soon. Today, you're in for a real treat because our guest preacher is Dr. Ken Alford. Dr. Ken and his wife, Cynthia, have been longtime friends of Paige and I know that he has a word from God for you all today. He is former pastor of Morrison Heights Baptist Church in Clinton, Mississippi, when we actually lived over there. But Dr. Ken has also served in churches in Florida and in Georgia, and now has come full circle back home into Alabama. Actually, just a few weeks ago, a couple months ago, I guess, he was actually the interim pastor over at our sister church in Hueytown, the Pleasant Ridge Baptist Church. So he knows us, he certainly loves us, loves our community and our fellowship. He's been with us before, and so he's certainly no stranger to our church family. Please give a listen to him. And even before that, would you put your hands together, give a warm First Baptist Pleasant Grove welcome to Ken and his wife, Cynthia Alford. And Paige and I will be back soon and look forward to seeing you all when we return. Bye-bye.
Well, amen. Thank you so much for that. That is actually the second time that I've seen Les on screen today. He FaceTimed me this morning from where he is, a long way away, and it was just like he was in the next room. It was so crystal clear. I love and appreciate him so very much. I was telling Cynthia as we drove up from Alabaster this morning that Les was the first pastor who invited me to preach after I retired back last August, and we moved back here to Alabama, our home state. Cynthia's from Mobile. I'm from Montgomery. And so he is a special friend for that. We were with you back in November of 2020, and I love and appreciate him so very much. And John, I was remembering that Sunday how much the worship meant to me. Cynthia and I had been watching different churches online, and just to worship live and to experience the great music and your instrumentalists and singers and you, brother, thank you again for leading us today. Haven't you enjoyed the music today? Hasn't it been a great blessing? It sure has been to me. Well, if you've got your copy of God's Word this morning, I'm going to invite your attention to the New Testament book of Hebrews. We're going to be in a little bit in Hebrews chapter 12. So if you want to go ahead and find that, I'll call attention to it here in just a moment. What I want to talk to us about this morning is what I believe may very well be, listen carefully, the number one sin in our churches. It may very well be. Dwight L. Moody, that famous evangelist from a bygone era, once said of this sin that I'm going to be talking to us about today, that he felt it was the hardest sin with which Christians had to cope. And listen now, he said that he believed that this sin kept more people from experiencing the power of God in their lives than any other sin. Dr. James Merritt, you may know that name, he served as the president of our Southern Baptist Convention some years ago, once said this about the subject matter we're going to discuss today. He said, "It is a blight that will contaminate you. It is a burden that will crush you. It is a blaze that will cook you in its own juice." This one sin, I believe, is the one that we ought to fear most because of what it does in our lives, in our relationships. It is a very deadly and dangerous problem, friends, that I've come by to discuss with you here this morning. This is one sin that you certainly don't want to carry with you into this new year. If you've not dealt with this sin in your life, I believe that you're going to come to the Word of God and its treasures are going to be hidden to you. You'll hit your knees to pray, and it will seem as if your prayers are not getting through the ceiling. I don't see any way you can be a vibrant soul winner unless you've dealt with this sin. It will cause estrangement in your relationships, separation and divorce in your homes, behind every church squabble and every church split. This sin is lurking in the shadows. Someone has said it will poison our worship, it will paralyze our work, and it will pollute our witness. I want to talk to us this morning about the horrible, hellish, horrific sin of bitterness. When I say bitterness, friends, I'm not speaking about our being sour about how life circumstances have worked out. I'm speaking now in our interpersonal relationships. That holding of a grudge, that harboring of resentment, that deep-seated ill will that we have toward others because we've been wronged some way. The writer of Hebrews addresses this in Hebrews 12, verses 14 and 15. Let's read that together. I'm reading out of the English Standard Version. This should be on the screen for you, but the writer of Hebrews there said, "Strive for peace with everyone and for the holiness without which no one will see the Lord. See to it that no one fails to obtain the grace of God." And here it is. "That no root of bitterness springs up and causes trouble, and by it many become defiled." Now, we have all seen bitter people. Amen? Or perhaps we've been bitter ourselves. Many times a bitter person is just hostile. You ever been around somebody like that? They just seem to be mad all the time. They are angry. It's bitterness. And they are good at fault finding. They love to find the things to criticize in other people. They know how to push your emotional hot button to get a response out of you that will do what? Confirm them in their bitterness. They are just angry, mean folks. However, sometimes it's not that way. Sometimes bitterness is internalized. It is turned on the inside. And it may be that a person just has a sense of sorrow about themselves. It may be that somebody is just sad and melancholy all the time and depressed. But if you pull back the curtain, you see what the problem is. They're bitter. Or others may come across as just aloof, cool, indifferent, not a participant, withdrawn, but just beneath the surface, there's a seething volcano of bitterness. And folks, understand that those of us who are Christians are not exempt from this problem. The writer of Hebrews was addressing believers. And I've been at this long enough, I can tell you, I have seen bitter believers. I have seen caustic Christians. I've seen my share of sour saints. Friends, I've even seen some mad ministers, some crabby clergy, and some pouting preachers and resentful reverends. None of us are exempt from bitterness, the sin of an unforgiving spirit. So let's talk about it this morning. First of all, I want to say a word to you about the origin of bitterness. Where does bitterness come from? Generally speaking, bitterness begins when there's been hurt, when someone has wronged us, when someone has said something about us negative, when somebody has said something to us that's harsh or critical, when someone has done something to us, when someone has taken something away from us, and we are wounded. And if we're honest, we'd have to say there's something that rises us in us. We want to strike back. Or we'll just hold on to that pain. Hold on to that hurt. Now, not if we're walking in the Spirit. If we're walking in the Spirit, we'll recognize those tendencies as sin, and we'll repent, and we'll get right with the Lord, and we'll get right with the person who's wronged us as much as in us is. But not the bitter person. Not the bitter person. The bitter person internalizes that hurt. The bitter person rehashes it in his or her mind. For bitter people, it's almost like they have a mental recording, a VCR, if you would, and they relive the experience. It's as if they hit play and rewind, and then play and rewind, and they go over it time and time again. All the while, what is happening? The root of bitterness is going deeper and deeper into somebody's heart. Friends, you can take this to the bank. Bitterness grows in the soil of a hurt that has not been dealt with properly. It takes very little soil to plant the seed of bitterness. Boy, does it grow, and boy, is it hard to uproot the origin of bitterness, unresolved hurt. Let me say a word to you about the outcome of bitterness. Look with me at Deuteronomy 29 and verse 18. It says there, "Beware lest there be among you a root bearing poisonous and bitter fruit." Friend, understand, every root has its fruit. Verse 15 of our text says, "See to it that no root of bitterness springs up." Friend, it always springs up, and it always causes trouble. Let me tell you about that trouble. Bitterness will always cause trouble, and it will trouble you first. Friends, I promise you, if you have unresolved bitterness in your life, an unforgiving spirit, it's going to cause trouble. It's going to cause mental trouble. It's going to cause emotional trouble. It will be like a cancer of the mind. It will be like an acid that eats away the container that holds it. There'll be emotional anguish. It'll cause even physical trouble. Years ago, a man named Dr. S.I. Macmillan wrote a classic work called None of These Diseases, and he talked about, as a physician, the benefits of just following the Word of God physically, and he documented over 50 physical problems that come simply because people have resentful spirits, unforgiveness in their hearts. You may say to me, "Preacher, are you saying I'm going to be sick? If I'm bitter, I'm going to be physically ill? If I don't forgive people?" I say this, friend, you'll be sicker than you ought to be. I wonder how many hospital beds today are full of people that have unresolved ill will toward others. They've got a root of bitterness. It springs up. It causes trouble, emotional trouble. Of course, relationship trouble, even physical trouble. But lean in close and understand that bitterness causes spiritual trouble. Did you see there in verse 14 where the writer said, "Strive for peace with everyone and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord." Friend, you can't have hatefulness and holiness in the same heart. They are incompatible roommates. And he links our being at peace with others with our holiness. He says, without it, no one will see the Lord. And friends, I tell you, I don't think he's speaking about just seeing the Lord in the sweet by and by when we die. I don't know about you, but I want to see him now. I want to see him in my life, in my family. We need to see him in our churches. We need to see him in our city, our nation, our world. We need to see the Lord. But it will not happen if we're not at peace with others. If we're harboring that ill will, if we are holding on to bitterness. An unforgiving person, a bitter, resentful person, is like a contagious poison that spreads that resentment to other people. I'm going to ask the fellows if they'll put Ephesians chapter 4 up on the screen. First of all, verses 30 and 31. I want you to hear what the Apostle Paul said. He said there, "And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption." And then in verse 31, he gives a catalog of some sins that will grieve the Holy Spirit of God. And notice what the first one on the list is. He says, these are things that are to be put away. He says, let all bitterness, that old sour, resentful spirit. And then he says, and wrath. That's a passionate outburst of rage and anger. Friends, that's speaking of settled indignation and clamor. That word means an outcry. It literally means screaming and slander. That's the Greek word there is a word from which we get the word blasphemy. It means abusive language. He says, let that be put away from you along with all malice. That's spite. Malice is plain old wickedness. It's a vicious disposition. You've got no end to evil. But where did that chain reaction start? It all began with that first word on the list, bitterness. That's why we have a remedy when you back up a few verses. Ephesians 4, look at verses 26 and 27. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. Let's stop right there. That's a good verse for married couples, right? We can say it this way. Don't go to bed mad with one another. Now, don't be like that comedian Phyllis Diller, that great theologian Phyllis Diller once said. She said, my husband and I never go to bed mad with one another. We stay up and fight. That's not what that verse means. It means if you've got something that you need to resolve it before you go to bed, because if not, it'll stew all night and it'll be a bigger problem in the morning. Amen? Deal with it. And then he says, and give no opportunity to the devil. That word opportunity means a place. The New International Version says, don't give the devil a foothold. Don't give him a chance, a place, any room. Friends, if you have an unforgiving spirit, it is as if you are saying to the devil, why, Satan, come on in. Steal my joy. Rob my peace. Destroy my family. Tear up my church. That's why he says, don't let the sun go down on your anger. Some years ago, John, when I was in Mississippi, I had the privilege of serving as president of the pastor's conference. And I had Dr. Fred Wolf as one of our preachers on the program. Fred had married Cynthia and me. He went home to be with the Lord a little over a year ago with COVID. But Fred had preached on this matter of bitterness and of forgiveness. And the next morning, really it was about lunchtime, I was going out for a break and a fellow was coming in the door, an older pastor, and he stopped me and he wanted Fred's contact information. He says, I've got to get in touch with him. I've got to tell him what that message meant to me. And so I said, I'll get it to you. And I said, well, tell me, man. He said, let me tell you, I've been carrying around bitterness for 58 years. I said, tell me about it. He said, when I was a boy, mom and dad divorced. My mom married another man. My stepfather, he was as mean as a snake. And on one occasion, when I was just a boy, there was a barn out back, and there were two boards torn off the barn and thrown in the bayou out there behind our house. And I didn't do it, but my stepdaddy said I did it. and he beat me twice, first with a paddle for doing it, and then with a bullwhip for lying to him, but I didn't do it. He said it wasn't much longer till a couple of sisters next door came clean that they're the ones that had done it. And he said, but I've hated the man ever since. I've been carrying a grudge for 58 years. If you were to say his name to me, if I were hooked up to a blood pressure machine, my blood pressure would shoot through the roof. And he said, he's been dead 13 years. I said, what happened last night? And he was honest enough to say, I started letting it go. Friends, it's a process of forgiveness, even walking down memory lane, even going back to people that are deceased and in your heart, forgiving them. And I was so glad to hear that, but here's what I thought. How many times in the 58 years had the sun risen and set and risen and set and risen and set? And he had given an opportunity to the devil and had that unresolved anger, that bitter root in his heart. Friends, I'm telling you, the outcome of bitterness is absolutely awful. Springs up. It causes trouble. And it defiles many. It does set off a horrific chain reaction. I'm so glad we don't have to close up shop and go home right now. Because I want to say a word to you about the overcoming of bitterness. And friends, I'm going to give it to you in one word. Are you ready? Here's how to overcome this root of bitterness that we're talking about this morning. It is through forgiveness. When you drop down to the end of Ephesians 4, there in verse 32, look at it. Be kind to one another, tenderhearted. Here it is. Forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. Look with me at Colossians 3, verses 12 and 13. We've seen some things to put off. Now Paul says some things to put on. Put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, patience. You want some New Year's resolutions? Use those words. And then in verse 13, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, here it is again, forgiving each other. As the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. Can we talk about forgiveness? Let me tell you some things. First of all, I've been at this a long time. Some things that forgiveness is not. Then I want to tell you what it is. Friends, forgiveness is not forgetting. Or just forget it. No, it's memory that's keeping the pain alive. You can't avoid the crisis of whether you're going to forgive somebody or not by just saying, forget it. Excusing somebody is not forgiveness. It's something noble you try to do. I understand your circumstances, but I'm going to excuse your behavior. No, when you think about it, excusing someone is the opposite of forgiveness, because excusing says you're not really to blame, but forgiveness says you are to blame, but I'm going to forgive you. Folks, excusing is easy. Forgiving is outrageously impossible without God. Smoothing things over, that's not quite forgiveness. Companies hire managers to come in, just sweep everything, Brother John, under the rug, let's just calm everything down. Not forgiveness. You know who's good at smoothing things over? Mothers. Mothers don't care about justice. They just want it quiet. Mama, he hit me first. Well, you hit him first when I'm not looking. Just hush, right? Want it quiet. Folks, quieting troubled waters is not the same thing as saving drowning people. Smoothing things over, not forgiveness. Let me tell you something else. This is what's holding some of you back. I know. We're not talking about tolerating misbehavior. We're not talking about condoning evil. Some of you are dealing with this matter of whether you're going to forgive somebody or not, and you're reluctant to do it because you fear if you forgive someone that basically you're saying the wrong that was done really wasn't a big deal. It really wasn't wrong. No, it was wrong. It was a big deal. That's why you're faced with the crisis of whether you're going to forgive or not. So what is forgiveness? I'm going to give you three R's. You ready? Not reading, writing, and arithmetic, but here they are. First of all, recognition. Forgiveness begins with recognition. You recognize that you've been hurt. And listen, it was deliberate and it was wrong. Wrong was done to you. We're not making it right. We're not calling evil good. You recognize that you've been hurt. And listen, I'm not talking about somebody made a mistake. You were slighted in some way. I'm not talking about annoyances, things that annoy you. I know he smacks his gum. I know she shakes her leg at the table. That annoys you. He keeps clicking that ballpoint pen. That doesn't rise to the level of forgiveness. We're not talking about annoyances. Don't treat misdemeanors as felonies. Sometimes we just need to grow up, right? To be mature, have even a sense of humor. But I'm speaking of recognition. When the hurt is real, something's been said, something's been done, something's been taken away, you're hurt. And also recognition means I recognize that something is rising up in me that I want to retaliate, or I'm just going to hold on to it and be resentful. Then comes the second R, and this is the real secret. After that recognition, release. Release. Where you are going to absorb, watch this, you're going to absorb the injustice done, you're going to absorb the wrong, and you're going to let the other person go free. You're going to say to that person, you don't owe me anything anymore, whether you say it or just live it out. You are going to cut that cord. You're not going to keep dragging that wrong that was done like a ball and chain behind you. You release the person. You make the wrong that was done irrelevant as far as how you see that person and interact with that person. Friends, to get to that point, you know what you need to do? Pray these two prayers. Number one, God give me new eyes. And secondly, God give me a new heart. Right? New eyes to see the person in a different way. See the person apart from the wrong that the person did. Just peel it away like peeling fruit. And see the person as a needy person who needs the grace of God, who needs the grace of you. Give me new eyes and then give me a new heart to feel differently toward that person. Recognition. Release. I'm going to let it go. And then the third R, and I want to tell you, this doesn't always happen, but it's the ideal, reunion. Our text here says, strive for peace with everyone. Sometimes it doesn't always happen, but here's the ideal. When you say to that person who wronged you, but you've let it go, you say, listen, here's a pile of rubble between us. This wall has come down. Now I'm extending my hand, and I'm coming over. I want you to be my wife again. I want you to be my husband again. Be my fellow church member again. Be my child again. Be my boss. Be my friend. And let's walk arm in arm together into a future that's risky. There may be some other hurts out there, but just bring one thing with you, honesty. Let's see where it goes. Let's see where it goes. That's the ideal. It doesn't always happen. Friends, when we recognize that we've been wronged and we recognize we're feeling bitter, we release the person, and then we seek reunion, I believe we are in the will of God. Let me close by just mentioning some objections to this matter of forgiveness. I think I can hear somebody saying, well, that's just not fair. It may not be fair if you've got a straight dues-paying mentality, eye for eye, tooth for tooth. But friend, can I tell you something? It's really the fairest thing you can do for yourself in the long run, because it's the only way to heal the pain of your past permanently. It is to forgive. Somebody might say, well, does that mean I forget? I just can't forget. Friend, I don't believe you get struck with amnesia when you forget. Here's the difference. Watch this. Lean in. When you really let somebody go, when you really forgive, the wrong that was done to you now is irrelevant. When you do remember, you just feel differently toward the person. Somebody said, the hornet of remembering may fly again, but the stinger's been removed. And I think I hear somebody saying, but that's not humanly possible, preacher. And I want to say to you, friend, you got that one exactly right. It's not humanly possible, but bless God, it's heavenly possible. What's that old saying? To err is human, to forgive divine. It is divine. Every time forgiveness takes place, it's a miracle of Almighty God. Someone might say, well, why do I have to do that? Friend, I tell you, because the alternatives are awful. What are the alternatives? Holding it in, going to eat you alive, or trying to retaliate. What's that old saying? I don't get mad, I get even. You know what's wrong with that? You can't ever get even, because no two people measure pain the same way. You get slammed, and so you slam back. And no matter how hard you slam back, you're thinking, well, it's not as bad as what was done to me. And here's the person on the receiving end going, whoa, that's not as bad as, you know, it should be. I didn't hurt you that bad. So they slam you back, and here we go. We get on that vicious cycle. The alternatives are absolutely awful. But friend, can I tell you the main reason we ought to do it? Because we have an example to emulate. Do you know that the Word of God, cover to cover, is all about forgiveness? Do you know you sang about it with gusto this morning about the blood, Brother John, and how the blood washes away your sin? Hey, I've got a question for you. Are you a forgiven person? If you're a Christian, you ought to give a hearty amen to that. So I'm going to try one more time. Are you a forgiven person? Amen. Yes. What right do you have not to forgive anybody? The way I feel about it, God has shown me so much grace. I ought to have grace on tap for anybody that crosses my path and does me wrong. Hey, friends, if the golden rule is do unto others as you would have them do unto you, let me give you one better, the platinum rule. Let's do unto others as God has already done unto us. And you say, that's so hard. Friends, Calvary was hard. The cross was hard. And if you're going to forgive, you're going to get a taste of the cross. Let's go to the cross to receive forgiveness, and let's linger there so we can offer that same kind of forgiveness to others. One last thing. I think I hear somebody saying, boy, I hope all those bitter people are listening to our guest preacher today. What about you? Does God need to take his spade, his hoe, and dig deeply into the soil of your life? Root out bitterness. Friends, you not only set the other person free, you set yourself free. You let yourself off the hook when you let others off the hook. It's time for us to let it go. In this new year, let's don't move another day into it with bitterness. Amen. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. We come now to this time of invitation. In a moment, Brother John will be standing down front as these singers lead us. They're going to be leading us to sing, I need you, Lord. I need you. Oh, my goodness, friends. We need him so desperately when it comes to our interpersonal relationships, to forgiving others. Maybe even today, you in your heart silently could call out that person's name and say to the Lord, I recognize I've been hurt. Might have been Bill, might have been Sue, whoever it might be. Call that name and say, oh God. I release that person. I've been forgiven much. I want to extend that forgiveness. Did you notice how our passage said, see to it that no one fails to obtain the grace of God? That literal reading is no one falls short of the grace of God. Nobody lags behind the grace of God. Friend, if you're not forgiving others, you are lagging behind God's forgiveness of you. You have been shown grace and mercy. Show it to other people. Let today be the day. If you've never been a recipient of salvation, you can come give your hand to Brother John, say, I need to give my heart to Jesus. If you've trusted Christ in another time or place, you can come and profess your faith openly. If you want to join the church, of course you can do that. But maybe some folks ought to be at the altar praying, or just come into Brother John, give a quick handshake, say, I need to let go of this root of bitterness. You do what God says. Lord, we give you this invitation. We mean it when we sing it. Lord, we come, we confess, we bow here. We need to find our rest. Without you, we cannot do it, as the song says. Without you, we fall apart. And many of us have fallen short of what your grace has shown us we ought to be and do to others. So for those that need to respond to this invitation, give them courage to come. Make things right with you. And then, Lord, even today, reach out to others to make things right. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Brother John's here to receive you. These singers will lead us. Let's stand together, friends, and somebody come as we sing together.
Lord, I come. You're my hope and stay.
invitation is over, but the invitation itself is not over. You can always go to God. You can always go to the Holy Spirit. We're here if you want to talk, if you want to pray together, or if you just need to kick the dog. I'll be the dog, okay? It's important that we get past the bitterness in our heart, the chains of bondage that have held us back, not only from being what God wants us, but from the blessings of God. I pray today that we leave here a different person, that we go out and we're light in a dark world. I love you. Brother Ken, Miss Cynthia, thank y'all so much. I've listened to this man for over 20 years, and every time I'm blessed. Would y'all give them a thank you for being here? Amen. Love you guys. Y'all welcome back anytime. Y'all come back next week. Ken wanted me to remind the deacons that y'all have a meeting immediately following this over in the fellowship hall. And so if y'all will gather over there, and we pray that God leads you guys and just anoints that time together. We're going to sing together. I'm a friend of God, then you're dismissed. God bless you. Love you guys. I am a friend of God. Yeah.